And actually really happened. It's mid-20th century, and I'm a track through fields in the Urals in central Russia, and sits on a cart, front of a cart, an old lady with her granddaughter behind her, and the horse pulling the cart is being connected to the reins that the old lady is holding. But the old lady and her daughter on a horse and cart, and sat next to the old lady is a man in a space suit, complete with his helmet and an ejector seat that he just clouds his spaceship from next to him. Of course, probably guess the man is Yuri Gagarin, the first man to not only orbit the Earth, but to leave the Earth and to look down on the whole planet. And he just arrived back from space in April 1961, and Gagarin's spaceship, though brilliant technology at the time, is rather primitive compared to the technology that exists now, just about technology, I'm sure, maybe primitive compared to future technologies. But in any case, Gagarin's orbit, though very successful, lots of things could have gone wrong, and some almost did, was ever so slightly higher than was planned, which meant that when he re-entered the Earth, the place where he was supposed to land had been missed, and he landed miles and miles and miles out of the drop zone where he should have come down. Also, the technology hadn't advanced that far by that point, so it's never been done before, to allow a kind of soft landing. You remember Russian space ships, cosmonauts had a dust down and a splash down like Americans did. But the capsule couldn't be slowed down enough to ensure a landing soft enough for someone inside to survive. So what happened is the cosmonauts waited until they got to 20,000 feet and then ejected. That's why he had an ejector seat. And quite by chance, miles from where he should have been, as he was parachuting down to Earth, he saw below him the factory where he trained as an apprentice, and he's trained in foundry work before he went into the Russian Air Force. Coming down, he landed in the field where the old lady and her daughter were picking potatoes. I didn't know who on earth it was. And he approached the old lady and said, "I've just come from space. I need to telephone Moscow to tell them that I'm all right." Which the old lady replied, "Well, there is a phone in the collective village 10 miles away. But don't worry, because I've got my horse and cart and I'll take you there." Which is how he came to be on a horse and cart dressed in a space suit. Being all together, sharing the earth, sharing the world. belonging both here and also belonging to something in the future, which is of God. But also about sharing. And I think this idea of sharing is one way of approaching this and trying to understand it. Because Jesus says that all his followers are one with him. They share life with him. Just as he's one with the Father, he shares life with the Father. So what is it about this sharing which both makes us one and also kind of makes us one community on the earth? Well, in the New Testament, there's a lot about sharing. And the word that's used, the Greek word called koinonia, which is sometimes translated as fellowship, it's sometimes translated as being one body of people, and it's sometimes translated as sharing. So, for example, at the day of Pentecost, where all those people were brought to faith in Jesus with the apostles, the community is described as being of one fellowship, holding all things in common, literally in common, and sharing everything they had, just as the life was shared with Jesus. St. Paul, in his epistles, writes of sharing a common task, sharing the goal, working together towards building God's kingdom on earth. So in other words, being one people, united in a single purpose, united behind Jesus, doing something together. And Jesus himself talks about being one with his Father, with the aim of bringing us all together into this community. Once Jesus was asked by two of his apostles if they could sit in glory with him, one on his left and one on his right, and his response to that was, that's not possible, but you can share in the task and in the ministry that Jesus came to confirm. But by that, we have to share both in Christ's baptism and being one people. But this is crucial, we have to share in his crucifixion as well, which means facing challenges and tasks and going through that experience of Jesus on the cross. And by doing that, we can then share the life of his resurrection, which gives power and strength to do much more than we could achieve on our own, much more than we could achieve just by ourselves, but by working together, by sharing that task, we can achieve. So belonging in the world doesn't mean then we're just limited to kind of a two-dimensional existence. In some sense, we kind of belong to a future promise as well. And don't we all feel that really when we look up into the sky on a starry night, a cold starry night? Don't we experience something of the wonder of belonging to something greater? In the 1980s, of course, the Americans and the Russians started to work together in space. The whole reason why the Gagarin was in space in the first place So sharing the earth, the Americans, the Russians, sharing the earth, the space map, the cutting edge of technology, existing alongside a horse and cart, technology that's been there since, goodness knows, their classical times, and still exists today, means a sharing in many different aspects and walks of life and ways of living. But if we think of ourselves as sharing this earth, then we can also think of ourselves as transcending it, rising above it, literally, in some cases, going into space. But for Christians, a sense of belonging as a people to Jesus, just as Jesus belongs to God, and sharing in that life. And when we do share in that life, you'll find it takes us literally out of this world. So let's now start. All our lives may be sanctified in the truth. Let us pray together to the Lord. But we pray that your church may be committed to the needs of the world, but never conform to the world. We pray that those who have called to your service may be strong in the faith of Christ, giving power to reveal his love. Lord, give your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, be with all who must make decisions that will affect lives. Give wisdom to those who appoint or elect positions of authority, guiding them with your Holy Spirit to seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless us, our families, and friends, and colleagues, in the decisions, both small and great, which we must make in our daily lives. Unite us in the love that makes us your own. All evil. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Have mercy on any who have broken faith. Restore them in your mercy to the life of love. Guide us where we can bring relief to any who have lost direction through the distress and misplaced trust. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you. risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice. come to this your table, merciful Lord. Just in the hour of righteousness, but in the whole life of all the great blessings. We are not worthy so much to gather up the crumbs of your table, but you are the same Lord, who made me to always have blessed. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so that we the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed in his most precious blood.
Creator of love and power, whose Son Jesus Christ sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. So confirm us in this mission, that our lives may show forth the good news that we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So we say together,
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us in the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, for giving up you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Strengthen us in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
God, Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you, and with all whom you hold in your hearts, and remain with you always. Amen.
Two particular things to mention to you. We're pleased that confirmation takes place in church during this week. I promise that I will attend the rehearsal on Wednesday and the main event when the bish comes on Thursday. But perhaps more significant for you as a congregation here is next Sunday, after this service, after about this time, is our annual meeting of parishioners and our annual parochial meeting, two meetings. One, the first, to elect church wardens for the parish. That's an annual appointment. The second, to appoint members of the PCC and members for the Deanery Synod. And there are vacancies, and I'm looking to you all, catching each of you in the eye, to identify you as the volunteers, the people that we need for the PCC this coming year. Thank you.
And even though we can't all be together at the confirmation service, the service will be recorded and you'll be able to hear that on the YouTube channel. So let us